Hi, I'm Devarto Sinha, and I welcome you all on the behalf of Vindhyan Ecology and Natural History Foundation for the Naturalist Episode 7. We are a voluntary organization based in Mirzapur, Uttar Pradesh, and our focus has always been to conserve wildlife in their habitats. Now, we are a small team of scientists, lawyers, and journalists who keep doing things which we believe are important for ensuring wildlife conservation. This includes wildlife surveys, GIS studies, review of new laws and policies, publishing materials in vernacular languages, and we have also filed litigations in courts for wildlife conservation. So you can visit our website vindhyabachao.org to know more about our work and read more about our publications. Now this talk series we started sometime in July. We were actually missing being in the field and meeting our friends in the field and doing meetings, which was not possible due to COVID. And also growing up, I just want to say that we have heard stories of wild animals from our grandparents, and we could experience some form of wildlife near our house also. It was in 1990s, and then we have still had forests and wildlife in cities. Population was less, life was slow, distractions were also less. So people had ample time to spend with nature and understand it. But today we are losing touch with our wilderness, and there is clearly a shortage of means to understand the rich wildlife heritage our country has. Now, if you see our textbooks and academic publications, which has been for a long time, they have been influence of the West. So we hardly used to get to know about our native wildlife until unless we carry higher academic research or we are really passionate about it. So, for example, like we all know about the polar bears, but very few might be knowing about the Himalayan brown bear or the sloth bear. And I also give an example, like I was at a zoo last year and I saw a mother telling her 6-year-old kid, better see alligator. No, I had to intervene and tell her that alligators are not found in India. What you're seeing is a mugger crocodile. It's not an alligator. So, and it's not just an urban phenomenon. So when I go to villages, people often use the term gharial as a synonym for mugger crocodile when they both are separate species. So in fact, very recently, a male gharial was spotted near Ganga in Mirzapur. And there is a mainstream newspaper which published a big feature on how gharials have infested the river. They have literally used the term infested the river, and they are a threat to the people's life. Now, we all know it's not true, but this is the level of ignorance, okay? And this talk series tries to address those notions and is aimed to educate people about the ecology of less popular species. And we believe knowledge alleviates fear about the animal, and it also mobilizes people to conserve, make them more proud of our wildlife heritage. So, moving ahead, I feel so proud to host Tarun Nair, who is a good friend of mine, and I have known him since 2010. When he was giving a presentation at a students' conference on conservation science at ISC Bangalore, and on counting gharials using photographic techniques. He was quite young that time, but his talk also won, he won the first prize in talk, and I was really impressed by his commitment. That time I could not talk to him because of conference issues, whatever. But we had a formal introduction after nearly, 4 years at India Rivers Week. And to my surprise, he was continuing what he was doing, like his research on gharials and crocodiles, but at a very large scale, beyond Chambal Sanctuary. Chambal Sanctuary is known for gharials, but gharials exist in many more rivers. They used to exist many more rivers, but now they are restricted. So my respect for him has increased manyfold. He is associated with ATRI in Bangalore. He's a member of IUCN Crocodile Specialist Group. And apart from this, he also a member of several management committees of riverine protected areas like Hastinapur Wildlife Sanctuary in UP, Chambal Wildlife Sanctuary. So here is a person who has decided to dedicate his life for conservation of the species which is not so popular as tiger, but it is one of the most threatened and critically endangered species and native to India. So Tarun, we are privileged by your presence, and I am sure you all will enjoy this talk. And I will request everyone to please feel free to ask questions after the talk, because we want his talk to be uninterrupted. So keep note your questions. He will be happy to answer all your queries. And you can use this option, raise hand from your teams instead of speaking abruptly, and I will unmute you. And alternatively, you can also post your questions in the chat box. Okay. So I will just move to Tarun. Tarun, see it.
Okay. Yeah. So thanks, Debatyu, for that introduction and for having me here. I'll just jump right in, and feel free to stop me or if you have any questions or something, because I can't see the screen just yet.
Okay.
Okay. Yeah. So what is a gharial? Very simply, it's a long-snouted fish-eating crocodilian. and its Latin name translates to Gharial of the Ganges, although the genus name Gavialis is a corruption of the Hindi word Gharial. Before we uncover more about Gharials, we'll go back a bit to see how this unraveled over time. And I'm only giving a very simplistic account of what is known. The Earth itself is about 4.5 billion years old, and what you see here is a geological time spiral representing major events over that period. And we have a record of past events from the remains of plants and animals in the rock layers of the Earth's crust. Reptiles arose from the amphibians of that era, and this transition is more clearly recorded from about 300 million years ago in a period known as the Late Carboniferous. And this is also the age of coal. And this was largely possible because of two things. One, the evolution of lungs and legs, which allowed these forms to breathe air and to move onto land. And second, most importantly, was the development of hard-shelled eggs, allowing the first reptiles to fully leave water.
I think your screen has went off again, I think. I can't see the PPT.
No, I can see.
You can see. Okay.
They just have hard-shelled.
Okay, fine.
Yeah, it's better.
Okay, fine. So this was followed by the Mesozoic era, the age of reptiles, starting at around 250 million years ago and went on till 65 million years ago, which is when the early terrestrial crocodiles appeared. And the ancestors of modern crocodilians changed habitat and form multiple times over this period. And basically, they had to shift from land back to being aquatic animals in the early Jurassic. And there were at least three independent shifts from a terrestrial form to that of an aquatic creature, and about nine shifts between freshwater and marine habitats. And given all these changes and how different modern crocodiles or crocodilians look from their ancestral forms, it's not correct to term them as living fossils and living dinosaurs, which is often what you will hear when people refer to or talk about crocodilians. The genus Gavialis, to which the Gharial belongs, likely originated in the northern Indian subcontinent about 20 million years ago, in what we know as the early Miocene. And more recent fossil Gharial remains excavated in the Shivalik Hills, North India, are dated to about 2 million years ago, between the Pliocene and the early Pleistocene. There's only one recognized extinct Gharial, which is called the Gavialis bengovanicus, and fossil remains from Thailand and Indonesia provide clues for dispersal through a fluvial drainage that would have been through the rivers of Ganges, Brahmaputra, Irrawaddy, Mekong, Saluin, and
that way.
Finally Chao Phraya. Yeah, so this is contrary to earlier theories of migration over through a marine route. Oh, wow. Yeah. So in my short introduction to the Gharial, I referred to it as the long-snouted fish-eating crocodilian. And the word or the term crocodilian refers to all members of the taxonomic order Crocodilia, which includes three families, and them being family Crocodilidae, which includes the true crocodiles. Then there's the family Alligatoridae, which includes the alligators and caimans. And finally, we have the family Gavialidae, which includes the Gharial that we're going to talk about more, and a species in Southeast Asia called the Tomistoma. The quickest way to tell crocodiles and alligators apart are by looking at their jawline. Crocodiles have interlocking teeth, where the teeth of the upper and lower jaw are visible even when the mouth is shut, while alligators have an overbite, where the teeth of the lower jaw fit into sockets in the upper jaw. Identification of gavialids in comparison is straightforward. These three families also share many similarities in their anatomy, in behavior, and physiology, despite having separate evolutionary pathways. And some of these similarities include adaptations for an aquatic life. For example, like the body armor or tough scales or osteoderms that you see on the back of these animals. They also have a laterally compressed tail, which serves as the main propeller. And they have extensively webbed hind feet. Then the ears, eyes and nostrils are mounted high on the head. So they can continue to see, hear, and smell even when the bulk of the body is like almost completely hidden under the water surface. The nostrils and ears can be shut when the animal is submerged. And a third eyelid called the nictitating membrane protects the eye underwater. They also possess something called the platel or the gular flap at the back of the mouth. And this prevents the entry of water when the animal submerges. And every scale on the head of a crocodilian has a dark spot. If you look at these photographs carefully, you'll see them. And these are sensory organs, have a sensory function. And they occur at high densities in the upper and lower jaws. If you look carefully at the upper photograph, you can see that. And this is useful in feeding and even to detect changes in pH in the water. These ISOs occur on all body scales of all the crocodilidae and on most scales of the gavialis, but it's not present on the body scales of the alligators and caimans. It's only present on the heads. And and one of the most remarkable parts of crocodilians are this four-chambered heart they have. And it has evolved the capacity for cardiac shunting. Quite possibly to support long periods of staying underwater. And this is unique because all other reptiles have a three-chambered heart. That's two atria and one partially divided ventricle. But crocodiles have a four-chambered heart like mammals and birds. But unlike mammals and birds, they are able to mix deoxygenated and oxygenated blood. And so the blood vessels draining the left and right ventricles have an interconnecting aperture known as the foramen of Panizza. And this allows some mixing of blood, but outside of the ventricles. And the mixing of blood is advantageous to their diving reptile. So right now, 24 species of crocodilians are recognized by the IUCN Crocodile Specialist Group. Although systematics and molecular evidence over the last decade have helped split some of these species and have also elevated some subspecies to a species rank. What you see here is a broad view of the distribution and populations. And you can see the alligatoridae are mostly in the Americas with one species in China. Crocodilidae have a wider range across the tropics. Four species in the Americas, the rest across Africa, Asia, and Australia. And the gavialidae is restricted to Asia. Here we have a range of skull shapes in crocodilians, from the most long-snouted at the top to the most broad-snouted at the bottom. And it's easy to imagine that long-snouted species are better adapted at catching fast-moving prey like fish, because that jaw shape means reduced underwater drag when they sweep their jaws sideways, while the broad-snouted species are better adapted to capture large-bodied prey or crush hard-shelled prey like turtles. Yeah, so we're finally going to introduce the gharial. It's among the longest of all living crocodilians, and there are old records of males that grow to over 6 meters or 20 feet long. They also have an unusually long and slender snout, and they're specialist fish eaters, although they have been observed on occasion to feed on prey like soft-shell turtles. They're also considered the most aquatic of all crocodilians, leaving water only to bask and to nest. And being so aquatic, Their legs are also too weak to allow them to walk on land like other crocodilians. So they resort to sliding on their bellies when they have to emerge to bask or to nest. Adult males like this one also possess a gadda at the end of the snout. And so while size dimorphism between males and females is observed in many crocodilians, with males being considerably larger than females, the gharial also displays sexual dimorphism via this very visible anatomical structure. And this is a uniquely gharial characteristic. In fact, the gharial gets its name from the gadda, which is an earthen pot used in India and Pakistan for storing and keeping water cool. The gadda itself is it's a soft tissue growth on the rostrum of adult males. And it's likely to have a socio-sexual function in displays to both rival males and to potential mates. And together with the associated apparatus, which is the nasal fossa, you can see in the image on the right, and the pterygoid bullae, which is an additional second sexual male characteristic. They're thought to have an acoustic resonance function, particularly in the production of low frequency sounds and underwater pops. So it's both a visual and an acoustic communication organ.
They have a visual and acoustic instrument on their
bone. Sorry, what was that?
They have like I think someone has unmuted the mic. Please mute yourself, everyone. Please keep yourself muted.
What's that? Should I cut it to you?
Yes, please.
Okay. Yeah, so the gharial is a river-dwelling crocodilian, a river specialist, if you may say so, favoring deeper sections of rivers with large sand deposits. They live in these social groups with a dominant male at the top of the hierarchy. And while such groups often have stable residencies at favored locations in the river, ongoing work in the Chambal has shown that seasonal movements of up to 200 kilometers have been recorded. And these movements typically happen between favored feeding and nesting areas. Courtship and mating occurs towards the end of winter, around mid-February. And you see a lot of adult animals congregating near potential nesting sites. And this is what a typical adult courting group would look like. And this is followed by nesting from mid-March to early April. So females will nest on large exposed sand deposits, like you see here. And they will often excavate trial nests prior to actual nesting and lay on an average 40 eggs. Colonial nesting is often seen, especially in larger populations, with several females choosing the same sand deposit. And females will also guard the nest. And sometime between late May and early June, after about, say, 60 or 75 days of incubation, the female will open the nest at the time of hatching. Although, unlike other crocodilians, she doesn't carry them to the water. Hatchlings from several nests will aggregate in smaller groups, or actually larger groups, known as creches. And parental care is well documented in the species, with both males and females participating in caring for the young. And they do so for a couple of months. I'll share a couple of stunning images that was taken by Dhritiman Mukherjee and appeared in a photo story a while ago. So you can see these large groups of hatchlings, and they needn't be from one clutch. They could be from several clutches, and then they're all and you see a large male guarding them. And these clutches eventually break up, and the hatchlings start dispersing with the rising monsoon flood. So the Champal population is the single largest and most important globally, accounting for about 85% to 90% of all nests. And again, here are more images of the Champal from that same photo story. And you can see, like I mentioned earlier, the importance of having deep pools in large sand deposits. And you can see all the animals congregating and basking there. So far, so good. Now let's look at some of the conservation challenges that gharials have had to and continue to face. Historically, and probably even as recent as, say, 100 years ago, the species was widely distributed in the floodplain rivers of the Indus on the west, across the Ganges, Brahmaputra, Mahanadi, Kaladan, and Irrawaddy River basins in the east. But these populations were either depleted or extirpated due to a number of reasons. For example, in the past, gharials were targeted by trophy hunters, skin traders, and local hunters for meat and eggs. And trophy hunting and the trade in skins stopped in the early 70s, especially with legislations like the Wildlife Protection Act. But the consumption, local consumption of eggs continues to be a threat in the Terai region, especially in the areas bordering India and Nepal. So populations like Katarniya Ghat and Narayanian in the Gandak do face this threat. At the same time, large-scale construction of dams and barrages post-independence was responsible for a range-wide habitat loss. Like, you can just see the number of structures that have come up in the Ganga River basin itself. And you can see the large number, concentration of these structures in the southern tributaries. For example, the Champal and Betwa, Ken zones. So, yeah. So apart from hunting and these large structures, fishing took its toll too. With its long, thin snout, the gharial is particularly vulnerable to getting entangled in fishing nets. And in addition to accidental entanglements, fishermen and fishing contractors were also known to actively try and eliminate gharials. So the animals didn't drown and die like in the cases that you see above. The image on the left bottom shows you what happens with if the animal tries manages to break free. But although it's broken free from the net, a large section or part of the net continues to remain entangled around its jaws, and this will restrict its ability to feed. So such animals often die after starving for several months. In other instances, fishermen, if they are trying to recover their net, will have been known to chop the jaws of gharials using a sharp instrument like an axe. Yeah. So following surveys in the 1970s, the total gharial population in India was estimated to be less than 200. And that's when the government, along with the Food and Agriculture Organization, set up the Indian Crocodile Conservation Project. And this centered on two activities. Apart from having trained a whole generation of researchers, the main focus was on setting up protected areas like the Champal, for example, and two, on the rare and release program. So under the rare and release program, gharial eggs were collected from the wild, artificially incubated, and captive reared for 2 to 3 years till they attained a size of about 1.2 to 1.5 meters. After which they were released into various rivers in the gharial's historic range. And by the mid-90s, the project was deemed a success because they released several thousand animals across North Indian rivers, and funds were withdrawn. And that only undid all the previous conservation efforts because the state governments didn't have any money to continue these projects. And by 2006, there was a population crash. Sand mining also emerged as a threat to gharial habitats in the 1990s. And this is a problem that continues to grow, especially with demands from the mining lobby for the denotification of gharial sanctuaries like the Chambal and so on. And to complicate matters, there was also this mass mortality event between late 2007 and early 2008, which caused the death of over 100 gharial in the Chambal. And the reason, several theories have been put forward, but the reason for this is not known conclusively. So following these declines, gharial was classified as a critically endangered species, having declined by over 80% over three generations. This was the 2007 assessment. And there was another assessment recently in 2019 that continues to be critically endangered. And I'll leave you with this recent distribution map of the gharial that was produced as part of this assessment. And I believe this is more generous than what the situation is, because although you can see 14 locations marked on the map, the species continues to breed in only 5 populations. Yeah, so I will end here and I'm happy to take questions and answer them.
Thank you, Tarun, for this wonderful talk. It was quite informative and also like quite brief. So if you guys have any question, then please raise your hand. We will take question one by one. Some noise coming on. Okay, there are some. There's some question, Tarun. I hope you can see it. The ISOs are part of gharial alone, not the population.
No. So it's present in all three families. In the alligator day, it's only found in the skull and the head of the animal. But in crocodilians and all species under the crocodilian family, it's found across the body in all the scales of the animal. Again, the concentration is along the jaws, but it's found throughout the body. Even in the gharial, it's found across most of the body in almost all the scales, but not entirely.
Okay, Tarun, before we move to other question, I have some questions. So can you tell me like any examples of gharial migrating like long ways? Because we come across very news that gharial spotted here and there. And it might have come from there. It might have come from this area. So can you throw some light at how, like what is the known range of gharial like movement? How far gharials can go?
So see, I don't have a ready answer for that really. Because I've been seeing some of these news reports and they're mostly or largely of adult-sized animals. So it could simply be animals moving with floodwaters and exploring new habitats and areas, which were all part of its historic range, and then getting either entrapped in a side channel or getting caught in a fishing net and so on. I don't know if these are migrations as such. They're definitely exploratory movements that you see in many animals. Some idea that we have, for example, the wild tagged animals in the Chambal that are being tracked regularly travel, say, 200 kilometers downstream and then move back to favored. So they go downstream towards the Chambal Yamuna confluence to feed on animal or to feed on fish, because it's a highly, I think, because of the nutrient load at the confluence, there seems to be an aggregation of fish, and the gharial seem to be tracking that. So they're going down to the confluence to feed. But these animals will go back to where they came from, to their favored nesting sites. So these are not one-way movements. There's some other information from animals that have been released as part of reintroduction or restocking efforts. So one animal that was released in Nepal some time back was found in the Hooghly, having traveled more than 1,000 kilometers. Another animal released in the Gandak was found in West Bengal, in the Mahananda. So there have been some of these long distance movements, but we don't know if these are these animals choosing to go there, or because released animals often seem very confused and they're just going with the flow. So we don't know what's really happening.
And Tarun, one more thing, like, because we all know this river interlinking project is there, and there are so many dams planned in central India.
Yes.
There are also found like K in Chambal. So,
yeah.
So I have two questions. One is like whether this change in seasonal flow has some impact on Gharial. And second is impact of this obstructions on Gharial movement. Because you say like Gharials move to 20 km downstream, they again come back. Crocodiles can go through land and they can cross dams. Like there are instances I read somewhere that crocodiles can like cross dams. Okay.
Right.
Is there any example of Gharials? Like one is like on the seasonal variation of the river on Gharial, one is the movement of Gharial due to the obstruction on like this on the river.
Yeah, so movement often depends on the kind of structure it is. So if there are dams across river, then it's likely that it's one-way movement from upstream to downstream. But with some barrages, and we know of cases from, say, the Gandak barrage, because barrages are not storage structures. They're just river diversion or water diversion structures. And the Gandak is operated in a way that twice a year, all the gates are open. So the river levels out upstream and downstream. And there have been some reports of Gharial having managed to go up when the gates were open. But these instances are rare in the sense that the gates are open for a very short period of time across the year. So only if animals are waiting downstream and like happen to be there when the gates are open, will manage to go up. But they are... obstructions, nevertheless.
Okay. So now we go back to the questions in the chat box. So people, you can also ask questions in the video as well. Okay. So, but I will take some questions from chat box. So one question is that, are there any ways we can get more involved in conserving the Gharial? Any volunteer intern program that you can recommend? Yeah. So this is basically how people can be like, they can contribute to Gharial conservation.
There are quite a few field projects. So the Gharial Ecology Project has been doing some long-term work in the Chambal. That apart, WWF has projects running in Hastinapur and in the Bias River, and WTI is working in the Gandak. So these are potential avenues for people to explore.
This is one more question. What is the story of the Gharial ball on the south snout? Why it is found only in Asia? Is there any like any evolutionary benefit to it? I think that is the question.
Why it is? Can you repeat that?
So the question is, what is the story of the Gharial ball on the snout? Why they are found only in Asia? So I believe the question is also like, what is the evolutionary like benefit of this snout, this ghara on the snout?
I can only guess an answer. I don't know what the evolutionary reason is. So benefits certainly because of their social structure, and that, like I mentioned, that it helps with both the visual and acoustic communication, two conspecifics. But it's also important to realize that there are costs, energetic costs to having an appendage like that. So like you remember seeing all those skulls, different shaped skulls, and I mentioned that the narrower snouts are better adapted to catching fish in the water because of because of the sideways movement that many of these fish eaters use. And having a ghara for such an animal is certainly going to create a lot more drag. So it might demonstrate fitness Yeah, so again, yeah, so this has been hypothesized for several other species, like why does the peacock have a long tail, although it increases its vulnerability to predation and so on. So it's possible that something like that is playing out here too, but yeah, I don't have any sure answers to that.
Okay. So, and there is one more question. There are many questions actually, so I will take one by one. Are efforts being made to populate gharials at other global geographies, considering they have relatively nascent population compared to other crocodilians? So basically, are there efforts to introduce gharials like in other countries? I think this is the question.
There's no talk of introducing them anywhere outside their range, but I know Pakistan is interested, at least some people in Pakistan are interested. The Indus used to be part of its range and it was extirpated there entirely. And the only place in the Indus Basin it exists now is in the Bias River, where WWF and the Punjab Forest Department have reintroduced some animals. And so there was talk of exchanging gharial for river dolphins, because the Bias has a very small remnant population of the Indus dolphin, while Pakistan has a much larger population. So people are like, we will give you the gharial and you give us the Indus dolphin. But I don't think that's making much headway given the situation now. But I don't think there are any plans to take it outside its historic range. Bangladesh might be interested, and there are occasional reports of animals going from the Ganga entering and getting caught in fishing nets in Bangladesh. So there are some ongoing efforts to add captive breeding there, but I don't know if they have sufficient habitat left.
Okay, there's one question from Shruti. So she's asking that, is gharial the oldest of all extant crocodiles? Why do you think it is restricted to India now? Are gharials social animal that you already spoke in that presentation? And if so, then are all crocodiles social?
They're all social in some aspect or the other. But there's clearly way more tolerance to conspecifics or to others of their own species versus a species like the saltwater crocodile, which is extremely territorial and really does not tolerate others in the non-breeding season. So that's not the case with the gharials. So they live in these fairly structured, you can call them family groups loosely. So in that sense, yeah, they are the most social of crocodilians in this part of the world. What was the other part of the question?
So the question is gharial the oldest of all extant crocodiles? And why you think it is restricted to India only?
About age, so there have been two schools of thought. So some have suggested that because it's got this extreme modification of the snout and specialization, that it's very likely an older form. But others have looked at, I think, the level of blood proteins, and they believe it's a younger animal. It's a younger lineage. Yeah, so I don't know if they've really figured where it stands.
Okay. So, and one more question from Ashfaq. Why has the gharial population reduced? Like, I think he's asking, like, why? What is the reason for declination of gharial to such low numbers?
I'm really sorry to interrupt, but I just want to say that from a school where two schools and some questions that the children are asking these questions. So if you could.
So yeah, we will take the questions. So I request you to raise hand option there. Okay. So there's an option for raise hand. So when you click on the raise hand, then I will take questions one by one. Okay. Fine. So Tarun, can you answer this? Like what I ask you.
What was that? Can you repeat that again?
So what is the reason for declination of gharial's population?
So before the 1970s, I've mentioned it was like targeted hunting for trophies and for crocodile skin. And again, that was the time when lots of dams were built. And along with dams, many of those reservoirs were leased out to fishing contractors. So even they were targeting animals and killing them. So those were the major causes then. And so the real low was around the 1970s when the project started. And since then, there's been some recovery of sorts because the numbers are not as low as they were in the 70s and early 80s. But many of those problems, apart from trophy hunting, continue even now. Fishing is a major problem because there aren't, the gharials don't do well where there is active river-based fisheries. Sand mining continues to be a problem. And the number of new structures, be it dams and barrages and water diversion projects that are coming up, make large stretches of gharial habitat unviable in the dry season. Because if you go to any of these rivers, there's hardly any water for long stretches. And because it's a species that can't walk over land like the mugger, it cannot manage in these kind of habitats. So it needs perennial sources of water and systems that have deep pools that provide year-round refuges. And yeah, but I didn't mention, but there are other threats that have been on the radar for a while. And for example, like the river linking project and the inland waterways. Not much has happened in relation to this project over the last couple of years. So they're definitely a danger, but we don't know how exactly it's going to play out in specific gharial habitats.
So if anyone wants to ask questions, like children, they wanted to ask questions, can you please raise your hand so that I can take these questions? Yeah, there is one question, Luke or Uke. Yeah, please. Please go ahead, ask a question.
What did the gharials eat at the time of the dinosaurs?
What?
Yeah, we can understand.
What did the gharials eat at the time of the dinosaurs?
So see, the gharial as we know today was not present with the dinosaurs. There were ancestral forms at that point of time. And if, given that many of those ancestral forms also had a similar jaw morphology, we would expect them to have eaten fish and other aquatic creatures because they were, those ancestral forms were thoroughly aquatic animals. But if you go even older, when crocodilians were terrestrial animals, then they were running around and chasing land-based prey.
Okay, thank you, Tarun. We have two more hands. Mansoor, please go ahead and ask a question.
Why is the snout like a lion? And how did their ancestors must have not had that snout shape? Then how did they get the shape of the snout?
No, yeah, their immediate ancestors would have had a similar jaw morphology, but before that, all kinds of shapes and sizes would have happened. Some were successful and they got selected, and the unsuccessful ones died out.
So Sarah, please go ahead and ask a question.
Can the forms of the crocodiles still change? Why did they stay in this form?
So these kind of morphological changes happen over millions of years. So why did it, why was this selected? Because it provided an advantage to target a prey or a group of prey species that were not being targeted by other species, probably. So it gave them a an evolutionary advantage at that point of time.
Yeah. So I see one more hand, Ashfaq. Yeah, please.
Uncle, but how much babies does a female gharial lay? How much eggs does a female gharial lay? Because in the picture I can see like dozens of gharial babies.
Yeah, so on an average they thought to lay about 40 eggs, but that often varies depending on the age of the female, on its health, and how, if it's been eating well the previous season. So it ranges anywhere between 50 and 90, 95. I think there are records of animals having laid up to 95 eggs, if I remember right. But that's very unusual. Those are not typical clutch sizes that you would see. So there is variation, but the average is close to 40.
Okay. One more, two more hands. One is by Amit Kumar.
Yeah.
Please, Amit, you can ask your question. I think Amit is not like there. So there was one hand on by Abdul Muiz Saeed. So Abdul, you can ask your question.
Yeah. When were the gharials discovered?
Hello.
Yeah. Please.
Hello. Hello.
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. സാറേ ഇന്നത്തെ വിഷയം ഹോമിയോപ്പതി ചികിത്സയിലൂടെ കോവിഡിനെ എങ്ങനെ പ്രതിരോധിക്കാം. നമ്മുടെ വൈകിട്ട് 4 മണിക്കാണ്. ജി സതീഷ് ആണ്
പങ്കെടുക്കുന്നത്. I think someone else's microphone was on. Yeah.
Okay.
Amit, are you there? Amit, please go ahead.
Hello.
Yes, yes, please.
Am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Hi, Tarun bhaiya, good afternoon.
So good afternoon.
Oh yeah, I want to ask, you can explain again about identification of male or female gharial? Oh, like according to snot?
Well, can you repeat that? Sorry.
Actually, Tarun, I'll repeat for him. So he's asking how to identify male and female gharial based on the snout.
See, so if you're going to base identification on the snout, you can only do it for adult animals. So if it's a large mature adult, often in excess of 4 meters, then they have a well-developed ghara. And then you can be sure that it's a male. But adult females mature much sooner, when they're closer to 3 meters, and they don't have a ghara. But if there's a immature male without a ghara, you wouldn't know if it's So if you just use the ghara to identify males and females, it's not a reliable method. So you can tell for sure that an animal with a ghara is a male, but all animals without a ghara are not females. And that's why if you're going to actually catch an animal and sex them, then you need to probe.
Okay. So, Abdul Saeed, you can ask a question now. Let's do a
hand. Yeah, about the gharials first discovered.
When were they first discovered?
Yeah, when were they first discovered?
That's a very difficult question to answer. It was first described by, I think, sometime in the late 1800s, if I remember right, or sometime in the 1800s. But people have always known about it because there are even old tablets from the Indus Valley civilization where they created these slates and motifs with depicting a gharial with a ghara catching fish. So people have known about the animal for very long. So yeah, so I don't know if I can answer when it was discovered.
Lukman Safi, he wants to ask a question. Yes, Lukman.
Uncle, how did the gharial were useful for the human at that time?
How were what?
Gharials
were useful for the human.
Well, if they were hunting communities, I'm sure they were hunting a gharial and conceiving their eggs. But I think some of the interpretations of these tablets and motifs from the Indus, I think they claim that people were amazed at the animal's fish catching abilities. And so the animal was looked up to, and maybe it helped people to devise fishing traps and all of that. But yeah, that's just conjecture. Nobody can really say for sure. But I'm sure there were others, at least some people from that time who were not only consuming animals. Maybe some people derived joy just watching them.
Sarah, you want to ask again one question, please?
What happens to the baby gharials after they are led into the water?
Yeah, so when they gather close to the water's edge, so typically what happens is several nests hatch at the same time and lots of babies emerge. So if it's a colonial nesting site, you'll have hundreds of babies gather at the same place. And that would also mean there are many attendant females looking after the young. And once this group is mixed together, and I said they form this large creche, it's hard to know which animal is from which clutch. So the dominant animals looking after these babies look after the babies irrespective of who the parents are. And these animals are looked after for about a month or two, mainly to guard them from predators. And because these gharial hatchlings are really small, all kinds of things will want to eat them. Large fish will eat them, turtles will eat them, birds will want to eat them. Land-based predators, if they can get to them, will eat them. So, yeah, so the parents are just trying to protect them from being predated upon. And yet, even after all the protection and investment, up to 90% of all hatchlings don't survive the first year.
Okay. So Tarun, I don't see any more hand, but I have one question. Okay, there is, and I will take the question. But before that, I want to tell you that I want to ask from you that will global warming or climate change will have impact on gharial or their habitats?
Yes, it's likely to. Couple of ways. One is with erratic rainfall. So typically what happens is eggs are laid in the dry season and they're timed to hatch just before the monsoonal floods. And in those conditions, the nests don't get submerged in the natural course of events. But because of climate change, if you're going to have disruptions in rainfall patterns, and let's say you have big rain events even before hatching period, even before the hatching period, then you're going to see a lot of nest inundation because of irregular rainfall. And that's one of the problems with structures like dams, because they do something similar. They release water in the wrong time of the year, often in the peak of the dry season, and that's when high water is not expected at all. So a lot of species that nest in similar habitat, including freshwater turtles and birds like the skimmer, you see nesting disruptions almost every year because the dam is released water at the wrong time of the year. But apart from these disruptions, with increased temperatures, we expect increased energetic costs, because the animals are going to warm up quicker than they would otherwise. And that would also mean them having to feed more often. And there's also a negative feedback loop, because increased temperatures mean reduced diving lactate thresholds, which means they take a longer time to recover from dives. and because of that they'll have to spend more time close to the surface, and being closer to the surface means they're going to get warmer because temperatures are hotter. So that's the negative feedback loop that will continue.
Do you think that also, like, I don't know this, that's why I'm asking.
And one more, sorry, because there's a temperature determined sex determination, you could see skews in the sex of the hatchlings that emerge. So if you're going to have much warmer climates, you're going to see a change from what you're seeing now. Yeah.
Yeah, sorry, my internet was just distracted. So did you get my question, what I was asking?
No.
So I was asking that in some reptiles, like, temperature has effect on the sex selection, like, of the new hatchlings.
Yes, yeah.
So is there similar observation in, for gharials as well?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay.
Yeah, so it is expected that there will be disruptions to the TSD process itself. And so it's difficult to know which way it will go, because climate change doesn't automatically mean warmer temperatures. It could also mean cooler temperatures in some parts of the world. So, yeah, we don't know how that's going to play out.
Thank you. So we will take two last questions. Okay, we are only sitting time. So one is Abdul Rahman. Abdul Rahman, would you like to?
Yeah. Yes, Uncle. Oh, my question is, see, you are mentioning that the hatchlings face a lot of predation. But if they survive and grow to be adults, are there any animals that will hunt adult gharials besides humans, or are they safe then?
So they're vulnerable till they are in the juvenile phase, because there are reports of the mugger crocodile, which is sympatric with this, predating on young gharials. But after they reach a certain size, I would guess closer to 2 meters plus, then they don't have any natural predators, really.
So it's only the babies and younger ones?
Yeah. So young animals see a lot more mortality, because so many types of predators can overcome an animal of that size.
Okay, thanks, Uncle.
Yeah, Ashfaq, please go ahead.
Does gharial hurt humans, or does gharial cause death for humans? Are they dangerous? Do they attack humans?
They're not dangerous in the sense that they don't come looking for people to hurt them or to eat them, because you see the shape of the jaw that's designed to catch fish. If an animal with that jaw caught a human, it wouldn't be able to do much with a human. So no, they don't go after people. But often if they are guarding their nests or looking after the young, then they can become protective about the young, and could hurt somebody if that person is too close to the nest or the hatchlings. But there have been reports of people who swim or who are diving in rivers where there are gharials. And if you're going to surprise an animal at close quarters, then it will try and protect itself, and it will injure somebody in that scenario.
Are they like naturally aggressive? Will they normally go after people, or just when they're surprised or guarding young?
They will not go after people. They're quite shy by nature. And in most cases,
I meant like,
what?
And like, some animals are very aggressive, and so they see humans, they may attack, but these won't.
These won't. No, they won't. They are scared of you.
I think in the case of also crocodiles or the mother crocodiles also, like they don't attack humans, like they don't go after humans, right, Tarun? It is.
Yeah, at least that's the experience from most of the species range. But there are a couple of locations. For example, there's a spot in parts of Gujarat, especially the Vishwamitri River, where there have been several cases of attack by mugger crocodiles. There seems to be another hotspot in near Lakhimpur Kheri in Uttar Pradesh. So there are these. There are a few locations which seem like aberrations to what is considered normal crocodile behavior. In most places, they are very shy and they just try and get away from people. But there are these two or three locations where there have been quite a few cases of conflict.
So Tarun, I hope you have 5-10 minutes more because I think
yes.
more hands. Yeah, Mansoor, yeah. Please go ahead with the question.
Yeah, if even if the gorillas attack, they'll do less damage, correct? Because their snouts are very thin, can only do damage on one part, very small part.
That's what we are tempted to think, but you must remember that a large animal, which is 6 meters long, is close to a ton or close to 1,000 kilos, and an animal like that can do serious damage even without trying very much. So it might not intend to do a lot of damage or not intend to kill you, but simply because of the size and the how powerful the animal is, it might cause damage.
So Abdul, you can ask your question.
Yes, uncle. Do human eat gorilla legs? Like
yes, yes, yes. That's known from quite a few places, especially along the India-Nepal border.
How many ears does approximately?
Some communities do harvest and seek out gorilla legs too for consumption.
Sir, which place the first spawn of gorilla, sir?
What?
Which place the first spawn of gorilla in?
I think she's asking like what is the origin of gharials? Like which place?
Of the gharialis form itself is from the Siwalik Hills in areas bordering India and Pakistan. And there have been records from parts of Haryana and Himachal also. So yeah, the Siwalik Hills would be the origin for gharialis.
Okay, Abdul Mool Saeed.
Yeah, do you pronounce it as
gharial
or
gharial? So, in everyday usage, it's called a gharial because that's the name for the animal locally. The word gharial is actually a corruption of the English, of the Hindi word, because whoever was describing it then mistakenly used gharial instead of gharial. So, although it's the accepted name now, it came about as a mistake.
So how many years does a normal gharial live?
That again, we don't know. The only records or reliable records are from collections and from zoos and museums. And given that it's a large animal, it's late maturing, one would expect it to live close to or even beyond 70 or 80 years. I wouldn't be surprised if it reached 100.
That should be in the wild, right? So in the captivity, they'd live for even longer. They'd outlive the people who bought them.
Yes, that's likely. So in the wild, if they're able to stay away from fishing and all of that, after a certain size, nothing can really kill them. Apart from human-caused mortality, they should be able to live to that size, even in the wild. And if they don't lose all their teeth and if they're still able to catch fish, because this species doesn't scavenge or is not really known to scavenge like many of the other crocodilians, Well, but nobody knows if it's constrained to do that under those conditions. But yeah, if it loses body condition and shape, and then it's difficult for an animal to survive. But if it's still in health and has its teeth, then it's going to survive for a very long time.
Okay, so now we will take just two more questions. Okay, so we are already like exceeding time. So Mansoor and Abdul Rahman. So first Mansoor, you please take tell your question.
Yeah, on the snout. No, because my teacher said that its real name is actually gadial because of the snout on its nose. It's it's like that in Hindi you say gadi, which is basically pot.
Yes.
Named after that.
Yeah.
Gadial or gadial?
So, da and ra are used interchangeably in North India. So, it's written
depends
with
on the accent.
R. It's written with R, but it's often also spelled with a D. But in English, R is the accepted, more accepted spelling.
Yeah, now last question by Abdul Rahman, please.
Yeah, you mentioned that after they grow to a certain size, they're pretty much invulnerable. Do
yes.
they, like you, some reptiles, they as they age, they don't stop growing. They keep on getting larger and larger. Do these creatures, do these animals also like grow throughout their lives? Or is there a point when they stop growing like humans?
So earlier it was believed that that reptiles grow, like don't stop growing. And sometime later that was contested. So I don't know where that debate stands. But what happens is as they get much older and larger, the rate of growth slows down. So they grow very rapidly when they're young. And even if they continue growing at a much larger size and when
it's
they're much
slow.
Older, it's going to be very slow. Yes.
Okay.
So thanks, uncle.
Yeah.
Welcome.
Thank you everyone for joining today, and I'm really glad to see like students joining to this talk, and they have been like, you know, they have made this discussion very lively, asking questions and like, you know,
I'm sure
Arun must have like the question, because all the questions which come from students, they are very like, you know, realistic and very like, tricky also sometimes, you know, sometimes
yes, yes.
asking, but they're very interesting question, important questions. I think we should have more like students to like
yeah.
our talks. So thank you Tarun for your valuable time, and I know you have been mostly in fields, and now because of COVID I'm not sure whether you are in field or even you're
no, I'm stuck in Bangalore now.
Okay, so so thank you very much, yeah, for like making it possible, and you know, this is very useful talk, and this talk I was waiting for a long time, like, you know, I wanted to have this talk, and today I'm happy that this has happened finally, and thank you everyone for joining, and Tarun, like, would you mind sharing your email ID in the chat box, so in case in some if future someone wants to talk to you, they can get back to you if they have any questions
in the show conversation. That's the box, is it?
Should I enter?
Yeah, you could enter.
Yeah, I just entering your email ID. So if you have any more questions and you want to know about gharials, you can directly write to Tarun. His email ID is shared in the chat box. Okay. And we will be uploading this talk within few days on our YouTube channel and on our website. It may take up to 6-7 days, given like all this thing. So thank you very much. Thank you, Tarun, for...
Thanks, Zibathu. This was a good opportunity. And I've been enjoying the other talks as well. So I'm looking forward to more.
Yeah.
Thank
yeah.
you, Uncle. Thanks so much.
You're welcome.
So thank you everyone. Please take care. Yeah, and have a firecrackers free Diwali.
Thank you.
Thanks for the talk. I really liked it.
Me too.
Thank you.
I enjoyed it. It was very good.